How great is God! The heavens declare His greatness. The skies displayed His awesome craftsmanship. Exalted in power, majestic above all. For centuries, artists have portrayed angels as beautiful humans with wings and glowing light, complete with halos, harps and flowing white gowns. But is that what really angels look like? Do they seem mysterious to you? Do angels exist and serve man today? Are angels males or females? When did God create the angels? Do we have guardian angels? Is there an angel of death? Angels have inspired all sorts of imaginative stories and depictions. But what's left when we separate fact from fiction? In order to know the truth, we got to dive into the Bible. What does the Bible say about angels? Bible Frontier, Jivitacha Uttar. Educating the body of Christ.
Angels. I have been hearing this since childhood, brought up and being taught about angelic protection over our lives. But there was one thought that I always pondered on. Do angels really exist? Do they really serve man? Will I ever be able to experience angels? And so on. But the good news is, we have with us a man of God, Jeshurun de Cruz, who has not only experienced, but he has encountered angels. And it's so pretty exciting and encouraging to hear from him. So Jeshurun will be hosting the entire series on angels, giving us a deeper understanding. Let me tell you, the journey with angels is exciting. It's super. So stay tuned.
So welcome to another episode of Bible Frontier, and it's been really nice sharing with you all that I have shared for these past two episodes, and I have experienced so much of joy just sharing all that I have spoken about. And I just want you to know that angels are absolutely real, and what we have been talking about is absolutely from the Word of God and what the Bible says about angels. And we have finished 6 points. We're going to go to the 7th one. I just want you to just be open, even to the Holy Spirit, to speak to you about angels, and even just confirm the word that I'm speaking to you. And even you can just read up the scripture references that we are taking, and it'll be nice for you to even do a study yourself on what these scripture references say. Okay, so we finished 6 points, and we have learned about angels and what they do, what order they are in their angelic organization, and many different points that we have covered as messengers and things. Today I just want to speak about Jesus and angels. And in the New Testament, Jesus has many encounters, or even many things related to Jesus had been announced by angels. And I just want to go through a few scriptures, because Jesus and angels is really very important. If you think of it, He is the creator of the angels. Okay, He is the one who has created, by Him and through Him all things were made, things seen, and we saw that in Colossians. For His glory everything was made. Now Jesus is really important when it comes to angels, because He is the plan of God that has been revealed to the world. And this is a really big moment when Jesus actually comes in the form of man to rescue sinful men. Okay, so the whole I just want to say the whole plan of God was to rescue man and bring them back to himself, to rescue people who had sinned. And in fact, the Bible says every man is a sinner. So the whole plan of Jesus is to rescue back. So we'll see right from the starting of Jesus's birth, and Jesus is closely associated with angels at birth, the 40-day fast, his agony in the Garden of Gethsemane before his betrayal, the resurrection, when those who go to the tomb, they see the angel and the angel tells them that he is not here anymore, he is resurrected, and his second coming. So all of these things that relate to Jesus, these are a few, but all these have a relation with Jesus, and it's really important to see how Jesus's life also had a lot of angelic involvement inside of it, even though he is the creator of them. But there is so much involvement of angels there. Okay, so I just want to open to Luke 1:26, and we'll just see from Luke 1:26 what it says. During the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, the angel Gabriel, okay, now Gabriel is the chief angel of the messengers, and those under him come as even scribe angels and angels that take down things, and he is the chief messenger angel. Okay, so he is the chief messenger angel. The angel Gabriel was sent from God's presence to an unmarried girl named Mary, living in Nazareth. Now Nazareth is a village in Galilee. She was engaged to a man named Joseph, a true descendant of King David. Verse 28 says, Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Grace to you, young woman, for the Lord is with you, and so you are anointed with great favor." Mary was deeply troubled over the words of the angel and bewildered over what this may mean to her. For the angel reassured her, saying, "Do not yield to your fear, Mary, for the Lord has found delight in you and has chosen to surprise you with a wonderful gift. You will become pregnant with a baby boy, and you are to name him Jesus. He will be supreme and will be known as the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will enthrone him as king on his ancestor David's throne. He will reign as king of Israel forever, and his reign will have no limit." Okay? There is further instances also where Gabriel speaks a bit more to her. But the important thing is that Gabriel is the one who he's the chief of the messenger angels. He comes and he announces this news personally. He comes and announces this news personally to Mary. And even though she's troubled and she doesn't know what it means, but he brings this message from the Father. And this is the beginning or the revelation of the plan of God that Jesus is coming into the earth. Okay, so the very first instance about Jesus coming into the earth now, and the Son of God being sent, like the most popular verse that everyone probably knows is John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son." Okay, that whosoever would believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Okay, now that was God sent. Okay, this is the first news that Jesus is coming. Okay, personal news that is coming to Mary, that God has found favor, and you will find, by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will find yourself pregnant with a baby boy, and you will name him Jesus. Okay, so this is the first news, and Jesus is the very first news is announced by an angel. Okay, we can see Matthew 1:20 also, and this is the angel appearing to Joseph, okay, in his dream. Now this is while he was still debating with himself about what to do, he fell asleep and had a supernatural dream. Okay, this is Joseph. "An angel from the Lord appeared to him in clear light and said, 'Joseph, descendant of David, don't hesitate to take Mary into your home as your wife, because the power of the Holy Spirit has conceived a child in her womb. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Savior, for he is destined to give his life to save his people from their sins.'" Okay? And this another angel, okay, appears to Joseph in his dream, and he gives the exact same thing what Gabriel told Mary. And this is really amazing, because this is the starting point of Jesus's birth, and in fact to be conceived, this is even before he was conceived. Jesus was conceived in Mary's womb by the power of the Holy Spirit, that the angels are already planning and already making them aware of what is going to happen. Okay, we can see Luke 2:8. Now this is the angels announcing to the shepherds who are tending to their sheep in the field. Okay, so that night in a field near Bethlehem, there were shepherds watching over their flocks. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared in radiant splendor before them, lighting up the field with the blazing glory of God, and the shepherds were terrified. Obviously, anyone would be terrified with suddenly a light. At the time, and probably electricity didn't exist, when there is such a bright light that comes into a field, okay, lighting up the field with the blazing glory of God, the shepherds were terrified. But the angel reassured them, "Do not be afraid, for I have come to bring you good news, the most joyous news the world has ever heard, and it is for everyone everywhere. For today in Bethlehem, a rescuer was born for you. He is the Lord Yahweh." Now, Yahweh is the highest name given to God, okay? And the angels say that He is the Lord Yahweh, the Messiah. You will recognize Him by this miracle sign. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a feeding trough. Then all at once, a vast number of glorious angels appeared, the very armies of heaven. They all praised God, singing, "Glory to God in the highest realms of heaven, for there is peace and a good hope given to the sons of men." When the choir of angels disappeared back to heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go. Let's hurry and find this word that is born in Bethlehem and see for ourselves that what the Lord has revealed to us." So they ran into the village and found their way to Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in a feeding trough. Okay, so this is angels appearing to shepherds, and we don't know why shepherds, because I think probably they are the most simplest folk, and they were probably the ones who would be so excited about the birth of Jesus, and they immediately found their way to Mary and Joseph, and they saw that. But the amazing thing is angels appeared. Even it says a choir of angels, and the heavenly host appeared to them with amazing bright light, as it mentioned in the word, that they announced the birth of Jesus to them. And this is such a significant thing, because I believe the angels were really happy, because God's plan for mankind had taken its had started, and it would complete with Jesus rising up from the dead, and he gives us life through his resurrection. Okay, so we'll read Matthew 4:11, another scripture concerning Jesus and angels. Matthew 4:11. Okay. Now Jesus is in the wilderness, and he fasts for 40 days, and angels minister to him after the devil tempted him, and Jesus comes against all the temptations or what the devil tries against him by the word of God. Okay, he speaks from the scriptures and says, so verse 11 says, "At once the accuser left him, and angels suddenly gathered around Jesus to minister to his needs." Okay, so this is a nice instance where Jesus overcomes the enemy by the word of his testimony, by what he speaks, and he speaks what the Lord had already spoken, and the accuser leaves him, and angels suddenly gather around Jesus to minister to his needs. Now I believe this is even true for us, because when we need encouragement, and when there is no one around God will send his angels. He will send his angels to minister to us. And be very open to the ministry of the angels of the Lord to just minister to you, even at times of need. Sometimes you may think that you are alone, or there have been cases where you feel that there is no one for you, and you feel that there is no one there to encourage you or speak something positive to you. I just believe that the Lord will send his angels to minister to you. And it has happened, like sometimes we could feel rejected when we are sick or in hospital, and we feel that no one actually really cares about us. But just trust me that the Lord cares more about you than any person can ever care about you. And he will send angels to minister to even you. Okay, let's see Luke chapter 22 verse 43. Here Jesus calls, okay, he's in the Garden of Gethsemane, and verse 42 says, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup of agony away from me, but no matter what, your will must be mine." Okay, so Jesus, after that it says, Jesus called for an angel of glory to strengthen him, and the angel appeared. He prayed even more passionately, like one being sacrificed, until he was in such intense agony of spirit that his sweat became drops of blood dripping onto the ground. Okay, now Jesus needed strength even emotionally, and he called for angels. He called for an angel to strengthen him. And in this state of Jesus actually thinking or actually praying, he actually says this, "Father, if it's possible, take this cup away from me." Means the cup of suffering that he had to go through on the cross. He says, and Jesus knows how difficult it is. He knows how difficult it is going to be. In fact, he tells his disciples what is going to happen to him on the cross. He knows the future before it happens, and he knows how tough it's going to be. And it's this agony that is there in his soul, and in his mind, and in his feeling, basically in his emotions that he feels. But he says, "No matter what, Father, your will." And he calls God Father there. "Father, your will be done. No matter what it is. If it's possible, take this, but it's not my will, but your will be done." And Jesus calls for encouragement. He calls for an angel to strengthen him. And the angel appeared, and he prays even more fervently. Okay, now even at that time when Jesus prays, the intensity of what he's feeling causes him to sweat drops of blood. And I read a story sometime back that scientists have actually proved that this happens, and the capillaries in your head could break when there is too much of pressure, or there is too much of anxiety, where the capillaries can burst into the sweat glands, and you can sweat drops of blood. And I'm not sure, but I've heard of this story where when in the army, in the trenches, where soldiers were waiting for the enemy soldiers to come, and in that level of anxiety, they had their capillaries burst in their head, and they sweat blood. This is absolutely true. What Jesus felt at that time. And I believe in a difficult circumstance, when you feel so much under pressure of going through a particular stage of your life or something, just call upon God and ask him to send an angel. Call upon Jesus, ask him to send an angel to encourage you. I believe the angels would just be absolutely, according to the will of the Father, the angels will absolutely be willing, and a special angel could be sent just to encourage you in a particular situation. Okay, so that is Luke chapter 22 verse 43. Matthew chapter 28 verse 2, I just want to read that also. Okay, now this is the resurrection of Jesus, and again we see angels coming in, announcing or being there in that place where the resurrection had happened. Okay, so just to read from verse 1. It says, after the Sabbath ended at the first light of dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to take a look at the tomb. Okay, suddenly the earth shook violently beneath their feet as the angel of the Lord Jehovah descended from heaven. Lightning flashed around him and his robe was dazzling white. The guards were stunned and terrified, lying motionless like dead men. Then the angel walked up to the tomb, rolled away the stone and sat on top of it. The women were breathless and terrified until the angel said to them, there is no reason to be afraid. I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He isn't here. He has risen. Victoriously, just as he said, come inside the tomb and see the place where our Lord was lying. Then run and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. I give you this message. I'm going ahead of you in Galilee and you will see me there. Okay, they rushed quickly to tell his disciples and their hearts were filled, were deep in wonder and filled with great joy. Okay, so this is the announcing of Jesus being raised from the dead, or that Jesus is arisen. Okay, one really important thing that I have seen in this, I see in this verse, it says, the angel says, he has risen victoriously, just as he said. Come inside the tomb and see the place where our Lord was lying. Okay, he says our Lord in that place. And it is because the angels, just as we treat Jesus as our Lord, the Lord is the person who has authority over you. Okay, a Lord is a person who has authority and who you give authority over yourself. And the angel says where our Lord was lying. Okay, and he acknowledges also in this particular statement that Jesus is Lord of even him. Okay, the angel that came and announced his resurrection. So he makes a statement saying our Lord. That means he acknowledges Jesus also as Lord. Okay, now we can also read Matthew 16 verse 21. This speaks about the second coming of Jesus. Matthew 16 verse 21, and Jesus actually prophesies his death and resurrection to his disciples. It says from 21, from then on Jesus began to clearly reveal to his disciples that he was destined to go to Jerusalem and suffer injustice from the elders, leading priests and religious scholars. He also explained that he would be killed and 3 days later, he later be raised to life again. Peter took him aside to correct him privately. He reprimanded Jesus over and over, saying, God forbid, Master, spare yourself. This you must never let this happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and said, get out of my way, you Satan. You are an offense to me, because your thoughts are only filled with man's viewpoints and not with the ways of God. Then Jesus said to his disciples, if you truly want to follow me, you should at once completely reject and disown your own life. You must be willing to share my cross and experience it as your own, as you continually surrender to my ways. For if you choose self-sacrifice and lose your lives for my glory, you will continually discover true life. But if you choose to keep your lives for yourself, you will forfeit what you try to keep. For even if you were to gain all the wealth and power of this world with everything it could offer you, at the cost of your own life, what good would it be? And what could be more valuable to you than your own soul? It has been decreed, okay? This is the part. It has been decreed that I, the Son of Man, will one day return with my messengers and in the splendor and majesty of my Father, and then I will reward each person according to what they have done. Okay, so Jesus speaks about his second coming here, and he talks about how he was going to be killed and he will rise again. But he comes to that point where he says that one day I will return with my messengers, and he refers to his angels as messengers, okay, because they deliver messages. And Jesus is going to come, even in the second coming it says that he's going to come with angels, okay. He's going to come with he's going to return to the angels in a very supernatural way. We don't know exactly how it's going to be, but he's going to come again to receive every person and to reward every person according to what they have done. And I believe according to what those who have received Jesus, he has caused them to be one with him, and they will be rewarded accordingly to what they have done and received. Okay, so that is what Jesus has relation, that's Jesus's life, and angels have been a part of the whole life of Jesus right from the very beginning, right to the end. Okay, quickly, I just want to talk about fallen angels, and we have already discussed it in the first episode. Fallen angels have actually been thrown down from heaven because they followed what Lucifer said, and this is point number 8. They followed what Lucifer's deception was, and they were cast down from heaven. And fallen angels have actually have a horrible deception in their mind that they believe that they can win kind of a victory or something of that sort in the spiritual realm, but they have actually joined Satan's rebellion towards God, and there is no way they can win any fight or they can win any spiritual battle, because God reigns, and our Father reigns over every realm, spiritual and every realm that he has created. So fallen angels are basically now called demonic spirits. They are not angels, or they're not beautiful anymore, because they have been separated from the Father, and we refer to them as demonic spirits. Okay, that is point number 8. I just wanted to touch upon that. So this was really exciting talking about Jesus and angels. And if you have any questions, or if you have something to share with us, or you can just email us on the email that comes on the screen, or you can call us on the number that is given. It is really nice discussing about the role of Jesus and his angels in his life. See you in the next episode.
How great is God! The heavens declare his greatness. The skies displayed his awesome craftsmanship. Exalted in power, majestic above all. For centuries, artists have portrayed angels as beautiful humans with wings and glowing light, complete with halos, harps and flowing white gowns. But is that what really angels look like? Do they seem mysterious to you? Do angels exist and serve man today? Are angels males or females? When did God create the angels? Do we have guardian angels? Is there an angel of death? Angels have inspired all sorts of imaginative stories and depictions. But what's left when we separate fact from fiction? In order to know the truth, we got to dive into the Bible. What does the Bible say about angels? Bible Frontier, Jivitacha Uttar, educating the body of Christ.
Send in your questions related to today's topic of the Bible study. They will be answered in the next episode. Contact 83-800-89064 or 70. Email us at broadcast@rophe.tv.